Good evening, everyone.
Would
like to extend a warm welcome to Dr. S. Jayalakshmi, who has taken out time from her busy schedule to address all of us. It's my honor to introduce Dr. Jayalakshmi to all of you, a renowned oncologist with over 29 years of experience in the field and currently a senior consultant at Artemis Hospital, Gurgaon. Talking of her academic qualifications, she underwent MBBS at Stanley Medical College in Chennai and her postgraduate residency program in radiation oncology from Christian Medical College at Vellore. Her post-MD residency followed by research positions were accomplished at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. In her endeavor to academic excellence, she has undergone various fellowships, including one in CyberKnife from Accure International, San Jose, California. She also has many publications to her credit, both in national and international journals. Today, she'll be discussing multiple topics with us, which can help us fight COVID. She will also emphasize on the importance of protecting our children during the pandemic. This session will be followed by a Q&A where we can, we get an opportunity to interact with her. And over to you, Dr. Jayalakshmi.
Yeah, thank you, Prima. And a warm welcome to all of you. Good evening. It's a nice Saturday evening. And before I start my session, I would sort of, like to ensure that all of us are vaccinated. All of us are, giving this idea to whomever we interact and get them to be vaccinated. We'll be surprised to know how many maids, gardeners, they are all away from it. So let me take that opportunity. So coming to, there is so much and so much of information which we all are getting. And frankly speaking, it's difficult even for me to process. So I thought that I would take this whole thing about awareness, quite a lot, most of us have. Where are we standing now? This care about whether there's a third wave or no, okay? And what can we sort of do so that we can prepare ourselves in order to encounter any of these? So going on from there. Just a moment, please. So this is how I would be, my perimeter, talk perimeter would be about what is the present status in the world, is the third wave coming, how are we going to protect ourselves, and a lot of emphasis on nutrition in COVID, okay? Now, if we see the current situation, let us start from India. This is the status yesterday. You can see the graph, which is going slightly thinking of going up. And I think, if we really stick to our COVID protocols, this probably can be contained more in the southern states, okay? And if we look at, Delhi, it is sort of flattening out, which is a little more encouraging, okay? And yesterday's was only about 44 cases added, no deaths. But the good thing what we are seeing even throughout India is that the, mortality, what we call as mortality, deaths are coming down, which is a big thing. And I think it's also because good vaccination programs are going on. Now, what is happening in the world? The world is talking about a third wave already, okay? And particularly in African countries, there is a third wave which is going on. And that is sort of reflecting in other countries also. You can see in UK, here you can see UK, USA, yesterday's statistics, I think there are about 1 lakh cases or so in USA. However, now the most encouraging part, what I would talk about is like in UK, they were sort of holding their breath, what's going to happen in the third wave. Their numbers, diagnosis increased, but the deaths did not increase. And they have attributed that to vaccination. It's important to know that 56% of their population is vaccinated with the first dose. So they're doing well. So probably even if a third wave comes, this is a prediction all around, if it is not any new variant which is going to surprise us, probably with the amount of vaccination, the cases may be more, but it's not the severity and it's not deaths also. So that's really encouraging thing. We probably should not be that scared of a third wave. However, yeah, all of us have surprises down the corner. Now, the other reason why I'm talking about, you know, probably we're not too scared is look at the statistics. It is about what is the variant which has caused from July. If you look at most of the countries, the steel blue color is actually the Delta variant. The one which is bilkul dulai karke gaya. Is it okay if I speak in, you know, English, or you want aadha English, aadha Hindi, which will be more comfortable? Apko?
Your choice.
Okay, I think I'll do a mixture. It'll be easier for all of us. Huh? So, yahan aap dekhenge the teal blue color, jo ye blue color hai, this is the majority sub countries mein, except Brazil. Brazil ka gamma variant hai. लेकिन ये जो डेल्टा वेरिएंट है ऑलरेडी हमने देख चुके हैं और हमारे पॉपुलेशन थोड़ा बहुत इसके लिए इम्यूनिटी अभी बिल्डअप हुआ है सो प्रोबेबली यू नो वी आर गोइंग इन द राइट डायरेक्शन वी प्रोबेबली मे डू वेल सो दिस इज द क्वेश्चन सबके मन में यह है और सब जगह में लिख रखा भी है आर चिल्ड्रन एट इंक्रीज्ड रिस्क द आंसर इज प्रोबेबली नो व्हाई आई एम गेटिंग यू सम ऑफ द यू नो डेटा There was this study which was done yahi India mein hi. It was done in about 10,000 children ko le liya, or it is a mixture, both urban, rural, dono ka hai children. And kitna seropositivity hai, yani ki wo, matlab how much have they been exposed to COVID. Dekha to adults ka dekhenge to 63.5% hai, children ka bahut kam nahi hai, 55.7% hai. So there is a good seropositivity even in children. And the other thinking is also that ek ACE2 karke ek receptor hai isi ke dauran ye covid virus hamare badan ke andar aata hai to ye ACE2 receptor jo hai bachchon mein kam expression hota hai so that's a good thing unke liye little more protective hai teesra ye bhi soch aaya hai ki because children ko jab tak unhone they are developing you know unko cold hai commonly they get one thing or the other to wo jo viruses hai thoda bahut related immunity cross immunity ho sakta hai so some amount of immunity already reh sakta hai it is going to be more protective so ek chota sa cheez how this virus gets inside ye to air mein hai हमारे जो नेसल एपिथेलियम यानी कि हमारे नोज के अंदर जो रेडिश पार्ट है विद दैट वी कॉल एज एपिथेलियम उस जगह पे यहाँ जो मैं दिखा रही हूँ दिस इज कॉल्ड अ की ओके दिस हाफ मून शेप जो यहाँ रहे तो ये जो है इट इज द ACE2 रिसेप्टर जो वो एपिथेलियम के अंदर है जहां जहां ये ACE2 रिसेप्टर होता है वहां पे ये कोविड वायरस आसानी से अंदर जा सकता है सो Understanding it the other way, suppose ACE2 receptors हमारे body में सब जगह में नहीं होते हैं किसी किसी जगह में ज्यादा होते हैं तो जिस जगह पे ज्यादा होते हैं उसके हिसाब से symptoms भी आता है So coming to see आप ये ACE2 receptors जो मैं पहले बता रही थी that is ये बच्चों में कम है आप ये graph देख लीजिएगा this is ACE2 receptor expression और आप ये देख लीजिए देखिए ये तो numbers when you see age 10 साल के नीचे को तो बहुत कम है whereas 25 साल के around this is what we call it adults 18 के ऊपर adults होते हैं यहाँ पे numbers देखिए और यहाँ पे numbers देखिए so ये थोड़ा बहुत तो इसमें protective होते ही हैं दूसरा different organs देखेंगे कहीं कहीं that is nose हमारा जीभ में होता है हमारा टंग में होते हैं जी सॉरी टंग होता है देन लंग्स हार्ट और कोलन हमारे आंतें तो ये एरियाज में सबसे ज्यादा एक्सप्रेशन होता है तभी तो जब कोविड होते होते लोगों को जैसे शुरुआत तो नोज से होता है चीक में शुरू होते हैं फिर सोर थ्रोट होता है फिर नीचे आने से लंग्स इफेक्ट होता है हार्ट भी इफेक्ट होता है बहुत लोगों को आपने सुना होगा कि अभी डेवलप हुआ अगला दिन ही उनका तो काफी सीरियस हो गया आजकल पर्टिकुलरली सेकेंड वेव आने के समय काफी लोगों को मेरे को भी हुआ तभी तो मैं बता रही हूँ आंते में दैट इज इन सिवियर अब्डोमिनल पेन एंड फ्रॉम व्हाट आई एम लिसनिंग टू फ्रॉम माय अदर फ्रेंड्स एज वेल एज अदर डॉक्टर्स बच्चों में दिस टाइप ऑफ दैट इज आंते अफेक्ट होके पेट में दर्द होना इज अ लिटिल मोर कॉमन तो ये भी वही दिखा रहे देखिए कोलन का मतलब आंते हैं और हर एक में कितना तक रिसेप्टर्स है, एक ग्राफ है। तो जहां जहां आपका रिसेप्टर्स मिल रहे हैं वहां तो कुछ ना कुछ सिम्टम हो सकता है, ये किसी भी कॉम्बिनेशन हो सकता है। और दूसरा ये एक छोटा सा चीज है, बच्चों के साथ जुड़ा हुआ नहीं है लेकिन ये मन में रखने के लिए ये मैंने डाल रखी है। आप देख सकते हैं, देखिए जहां एक्सप्रेशन ज्यादा है यानी कि सीओपीडी यानी कि स्मोकर्स में जो लंग होता है वो चेंज को सीओपीडी बोलते हैं, वहां पे ACE2 ज्यादा होते हैं। हार्ट डिजीज CVD कार्डियोवास्कुलर डिजीज ज्यादा होते हैं, Type 2 डायबिटीज ज्यादा होते हैं, हाइपरटेंशन थोड़ी सी कम है बट देन दैट इज ओनली इन द रीनल एरिया। सो दीज आर द एरियाज जहां उन लोगों को जो कोमोबिडिटीज हम बोलते हैं जिस वजह से ये और सीरियस बनता है।
मैम सॉरी इंटरप्ट, फॉर चैनल चेन्नई कोलीग्स आर रिक्वेस्टिंग इफ वी कैन कंटिन्यू इन इंग्लिश।
ओके फाइन, सो इज इट ओके इफ आई कंटिन्यू इन इंग्लिश ओनली कंप्लीटली?
या
श्योर, राइट, फाइन, ओके। So now, until now, I was talking about how much of the ACE2 receptors are expressed, and it is the key for the COVID to come inside. It is mainly expressed in the epithelium, what we call the red surface inside the nose. Apart from that, it is expressed in the tongue, in the lungs, heart, and in the colon, which is the large intestine. Now coming to children. Most of the symptoms, whatever can happen in them, is basically what we have heard already: fever, fatigue, pain in the muscles, what we call as myalgia, headache, cough, sore throat. In children, there can be this type of rashes. This is a little more common. So what we can expect is that, particularly in the nails, in the toenails. And the other thing what they have seen in children is this, that is abdominal involvement like diarrhea, vomiting and things like that. Now, one thing what we need to be a little, happy about is that 16% of the children are asymptomatic. They don't have any symptom, just like many adults also have been asymptomatic. And in the children, it may even go up to 50%. 50% of children may not have any symptoms. There are other things also. This thing, what I'm going to tell you now, is true for children and adults. That is, current evidence suggests that children with medical complexity, any genetic problems, neurological problems, metabolic conditions, congenital heart disease, heart may hold, what we call it. So all these have an increased risk for severe illness from COVID, just like how it has been in adults. Similar to adults, children with obesity, this is a very common problem now. So children with obesity, diabetes, asthma, cancer, chronic lung disease, sickle cell disease, immunosuppression. When you say immunosuppression, it can be because of any other diseases along with it. So all these people are at increased risk for severe illness from the same COVID. So what is the key to better withstand COVID? So the keys are basically three. One is COVID appropriate behavior, mask, distance. And this has been told of, to a great extent, educated people are all following. I'm not even going into it. And the next, which I am going to insist on, is a better nutrition. And the third, of course, is vaccination. Let's be clear, until now in children, that is in the population up to 12 years at least, it is not yet common. But beyond 12 years, in the US at least, it has started. But in others, it has not yet come in. It is probably on the way. Now, better nutrition. When we say better nutrition, we all know that, you know, a nutrition plays a great role in the recovery from any illness. But do we have any data for COVID? Yeah, we do have. Now, this is what I wanted to show you. Now, here, all that I want you to see is that, you know, these dots, when you see them, the correlation, when it is strong, the color is stronger. So here, when you see these dots, you can see vitamin D, vitamin B12, vitamin C, and zinc. You can see the very strong correlation for incidence of COVID, for deaths from COVID. In all these, you can see that it plays a major role. So that means that the better vitamin D you have, the incidence is less. Okay, the better vitamin B12 you have, the deaths are less, they withstand it better. There are data which are suggesting in COVID maintenance of nutrition is going to make a great difference for anybody, whether it is children or adults. Coming on to vitamin D, where all do we get vitamin D? The commonest we all know is sunlight, free source. Now, apart from this, these are the other foods which you can get. Important one is mushrooms also, that is to be seen. The skin produces 90% of the vitamin D of which the body needs. So when you're exposed to the sun, you can see here, the ultraviolet radiation then converts. This is produced in the adipocytes. When we say adipocytes, that means the fat cells. So vitamin D is produced in the fat cells. So being fat is also good here, right? And here, when do we have to, okay? There are so many various, some people say early morning, some people say no, mid afternoon. The best time is from 10 to 3 when the UV rays are intense and the body is also more efficient in making the vitamin D. Now, the important part here is that light-skinned individuals, they need only 20 minutes of exposure, maybe 3 to 4 times. But darker individuals, because when they have more melanin, they require more exposure because their efficiency of making vitamin D because of the melanin pigment is lesser. So they require about 10 to 20 minutes more. And it is also recommended that we expose at least 18% of the body, which is arms without, dresses without long sleeves. That means our arms, complete arms have to be exposed, face. And important is please don't wear a sunscreen and go on to the sun. Now, what are the reasons that we may have a low vitamin D? Mainly an indoor lifestyle in urban areas, wearing head coverings and covering the hands and forearms. And our darker skin and air pollution. An Indian study has been done, which clearly shows that there is a definite reduction in polluted areas. So these are the reasons. If we can correct these, so we probably are walking towards better vitamin D. Again, I've told everything about a sun exposure. Certain things here I wanted to tell was that, sitting inside a sunny window doesn't count because glass filters out the UV rays. And to some extent, when you should sit in the shade also, you can make, but not always, not completely. So we do have another Indian study. They have enrolled 100 infants and asked their mothers to record their time, duration, and body area exposed during sunbath every day, starting at 6 weeks of age. The study found that the exposure of as low as just 30 minutes of sunlight per week, with about 40% of the child's body exposed to the sunlight, can actually achieve adequate vitamin D. We don't have to add anything. Of course, the ideal time again here is from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. So we have got enough data even here in India that, we probably can just utilize sunlight. Before I just go on to the other one more small thing I would like to add is there is some data to say that mushrooms, particularly if you expose them to sunlight and then cook it, again, the vitamin D content increases. The other thing, next part of the nutrition is vitamin B12. You'll be very surprised how many of us are deficient in vitamin B12. And that is a cause of a lot of fatigue and weakness in many of us. The most important thing for us to remember is that it is not found naturally in foods like fruits or vegetables in vegetarian food. Very few vegetarian foods contain enough vitamin B12. So the vitamin B12 is very high in most of the non-vegetarian foods. So non-vegetarians, in general, we don't see much of a deficiency. These are some vegan sources and vegetarian sources of vitamin B12, Brussels sprouts, avocado, broccoli. We can try and kale, okay, green apples. We can try and add them. And then now moving on to the next vitamin, which is of a great importance here, particularly in preventing COVID, is vitamin C. What here we need to remember is that vitamin C cannot be stored in the body. So we need to include it in the diet. Now these are the ones where you can see vitamin C. Easy source is guava. And some which many of us do not know is also the bell peppers, red and yellow bell peppers. And the other thing is these are the groups which are actually at risk of vitamin C inadequacy. We can see smokers are at risk. Infants fed only boiled milk. And of course, those who eat very limited foods. I wanted to add a small word about a superfood which is taking a lot of importance nowadays, moringa. It's also called drumstick leaves. Now, these leaves have 7 times more vitamin C than oranges and 15 times more potassium. Yeah, it's packed with antioxidants, but a small word of caution not to be taken by pregnant women and breastfeeding mothers. And in alternative systems of medicine, it's also recommended not to be taken during monsoon. The last but not least and very important part of nutrition is protein. Here again, I wanted to stress the importance of protein in COVID actually. Now I wanted to quote this study here to see this when you say VTE, that is clots, what we commonly call as clots, venous thromboembolism, clots. ARDS is the lung involvement, ICU admissions, readmissions within 19 days. Now, when we say protein, albumin is a great indicator of protein. And look at all these stars. So what we can see is that the importance that when the albumin level was low, it was directly correlated with more thromboembolisms, more risk of ARDS, more ICU admissions, more readmissions, and the total adverse events were definitely more. Of course, there are others also. Wherever you can find the star, there are positive correlations. There are others. I'm sticking to the protein part here for us to understand that, you know, how even that has been correlated, particularly in COVID. So what are the requirements? You can see this. You can see in most of the, you know, if you Google it, you're able to get. But what I wanted to, you know, emphasize here is that as around about a gram per kg body weight we need per day. These are the people here, we never even know that they need more, you know, where a normal is around 0.8 to 1 gram per kg body weight. When it is post-operative, after a surgery, they need more, 1.1 to 1.5 grams. It is because that is needed for the healing. Where there is sepsis, when we say sepsis, that is infection. Again, see, it is 1.2 to 1.5 grams per kg body weight. When there is multiple trauma, those who have had fractures, those who have had accidents, when they recover, look at what is the necessity, 1.8, and burns. Where there has been any form of burns, whether it's burns, scald, oil, hot oil poured in a very, you know, great area, these areas, they require much higher amount of protein because they shed a lot of protein in the serum, in the secretions there, in that area, in the injured area. So these are areas where we have to concentrate more. Now, how much do they need? This is something which just shows you how it is necessary from even 1 to 4 years and up to your growing child. There is a continuous need for protein, which increases later as adolescence comes in because the growth spurt is there. The Indian Market Research Bureau's report states that protein deficiency stands at more than 80%. And when we say how the deficiency, all of us can really identify with this sort of a regular diet. It is a cup dal, 1 cup dal, 1 glass of milk, or 1 cup of yogurt. And these all only contain only 7 to 8 grams of protein. Whereas if you take a normal adult, who's about 50 kgs, they require 50 grams of protein. Where will you get the other 42 grams? So to get the regular daily requirement of about 50 to 60 also, that means we have to take 8 bowls of dal or drink 7 to 8 glasses of milk. Namumkin, it's not possible. So there is needs to be a mixture. A mixed diet is what is actually, which can, you know, bring up the same amount of proteins what the body needs for their everyday use. These are the problems which occur when there is less protein. Most of it, you know, developmental abnormalities. Important one in children is poor concentration, delayed growth rates, lowered immunity, slowed wound healing. All these are because of a deficient protein. Now, protein, the most densest proteins come from animal proteins. So gram for gram, it is much higher value than when you compare it to your vegetarian proteins. So here are some values. Same thing here also. You can see the white meat, which is basically fish or chicken. These are much better, although red meat is more denser. It has other problems also. So we generally tend to sort of avoid red meat, or rather have it maybe only once a week or so, more towards white meat and eggs. And these are certain vegetarian proteins, which can, again, the nutritive value is given. The protein content of each gram. Do you know that, you know, moong dal is a much better protein than other things? So masoor is, again, you know, gram for gram is a better protein than even your chane ki dal. So these are things that we need to understand and sort of assimilate. Again, certain, or now here I thought I'll add on this slide, because, you know, there are certain places where we also do not know, you know, sweet potatoes. I said sweet potatoes, it's starch, but yes, it has got some amount of protein. Cucumbers also, to some extent, there is protein. So these are things where we can sort of, you know, look at it and add into our own diet. Now, how can we increase the absorption of proteins? We can eat acidic foods, like, you know, orange juice or vinegar, very common thing, you know, when most of us, where you take non-veg, particularly when you look at the older people, they'll tell you, have a glass of lemon juice along with it when you finish having the meat or something like that. So this helps to assimilate proteins, okay? Because it in a more acidic environment, the proteases are broken down and it helps to absorb it better. Take vitamin B6, more of vitamin D, B, that again helps to break down the protein. And the most important part, which I would like to stress, is adding carbohydrates. Many of us think that, you know, just taking a protein will be helpful. No way. You know, in order for a protein to be digested, we need to consume enough carbohydrates. Why? Because by taking carbohydrates, it releases insulin. And that is what will actually help your muscles to absorb the amino acids. So you have to add enough carbohydrates. And that is why we have our, you know, Indian diet. If you see, yeah, we use dal. The dal has a lesser protein value, but then it has got protein as well as carbohydrate. So if you actually consume enough dal, the body is able to assimilate better because the carbohydrate is there in the dal itself. There I stop with the, you know, how nutrition helps. And I'll just like to add one word about how vaccination would help. You see this slide where vaccination, you know, and non-vaccinated area. So it just helps to spread. When you see the green ones, they are anyway having immunity, whereas the red ones are the ones who are infected. So here nobody is immunized and the disease spreads freely. A few people are immunized, but still there is a considerable amount of disease spread. And you can see the number of greens still remaining there, those who had a sort of an innate natural immunity. Whereas look at when a considerable number are vaccinated, the number of spread is much, much lesser. So another thing is, I wanted to put this slide to show how, you know, there was a palpable decrease in the numbers of measles once vaccine was introduced. There was very high numbers, and the mortality, when we say below 1 year, was very, very high before the 1960s. Around the 1960s, it was introduced, and this is worldwide data. Look at where it is now. So vaccination helps. And with that, I close this topic, open it for any discussion. Thank you for that patient hearing.
Thank you,
ma'am.
So anybody has any questions, you may please post it on the Q&A app.
Can you please move on to, is that vitamin D, B12?
Could you please move on to the vitamin D and B12 slide?
Okay, just a minute. There are a few slides in vitamin D. Yeah, it starts from here. Is this the one you wanted, or the one which shows the, you know, what all are they? This one?
Okay, Prakash, can I give him rights to speak, Premo?
Yeah, sure.
Satya Prakash, if you can raise your hands, it will help me. Satya Prakash, I've given you rights to speak. You may unmute and ask your question, please.
Madam, yes. I wanted to know from which food we can get vitamin D and B12.
I've put on the foods also. Basically vitamin D is from mushrooms, okay? And certain other foods, just a minute here. Milk, of course. Is that showing? Yeah. Yeah, so mushrooms and milk. Here, these are your foods, right? Of course, egg and other foods also. But the most important is actually sunlight.
Okay, and okay. Next one, B12.
Mm. B12. B12 is from most of your other, all your green vegetables, your sprouts. Now, that is one thing very important I wanted to tell. Sprouts, when you take sprouts, I've seen this habit of, boiling, putting some onions. You can put anything into it. You want to increase the value of it, increase the taste, and all that is fine. Please don't boil, okay? You are taking off its value, nutritive value of B12. What we should understand is vitamin B and vitamin C are called water-soluble vitamins. So the minute you boil, all of it is gone. So when you're using sprouts, you have to use it just like that, okay? No boiling. And you add whatever you want with it. So these are things which are very rich in vitamin B. Another thing is nuts, most of the nuts. So a handful of nuts, that is a practice with most of us, maybe about 4 or 5 badam per person, 4 or 5 akroot, okay? Put all the nuts, whatever you want. Most important is, your pumpkin seeds. You don't have to, go on to only badam and things like that. Simple seeds like pumpkin seeds, sunflower seeds. Just put a little into whatever you're eating and then have. That's a very simple technique. You can even put it into your own vegetables when you're cooking. At the last minute, we all add some flavors, okay? Roasted peanuts we add. Sometimes we add coconut. Why we can't add any of these nuts also? Powdered nuts.
Thank you, madam.
Yeah.
Thank you, Satya Prakash. Ma'am, the next question is, should we take Dolo 650 after vaccination, even if there is no fever, to prevent fever?
Yeah, in one sense, I would say yes, because it's not just about fever. If you notice after vaccination, many have had body pains all over. Okay, that is one thing. Another is pain at the site of injection. So these are things which keep persisting for about 1.5 days or so. That is why we always say, take it along with it and take for at least about 1 day, twice a day or so, take it for about a day after the. In fact, in most of, what happened in our hospital, because we were one of the first to receive the vaccine, right? It was January 18th, I still remember. So all of us went there waltzing, not knowing much about it. We all go with, when we give it to children, unko to hum pehle feed kar lete hain, syrup ko kerosene karke dete hain. Hum log to kuch nahi lete the. And then the other day, the next day, all our WhatsApp groups was full of this, I'm having pain here, I'm having fever here. So it's not just about fever. It is about your body pains and what we call as malaise or fatigue. So the Dolo does help to prevent. That is why we say. But if you don't want to take it, if you can manage, there is no problem about it. Generally, whatever symptoms along with this goes off in 1 day.
Thank you. The next question is from Shweta Singh. She asks, is giving influenza vaccine helpful for children in the present scenario?
Yeah. So in the sense that, the influenza vaccine from, I'm not a pediatrician. But I am talking to you about my understanding of this whole thing. Now, the influenza is a seasonal problem. And the vaccine actually has to mirror that. If you notice in places like US and all, there is a sort of a study which goes on about 3 months before the start of the influenza season. They find which could be the probable ones and then they offer the vaccine. So before, if that such a thing is done here, it is definitely going to be helpful, number one. Number two is, now whether COVID, no COVID, whether other problems or no problems, jo season aayega, you know, then upper respiratory influenza and other diseases are a problem. So it is of benefit. It's not that it is not of benefit. It has its own place.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question is from Aditya. He is requesting for the slide deck for reference. Is it
okay? Yeah, you can take it. That's not, I think I'll, you know, send it to you. People, you can take it. That's not a problem.
Thank you. So Aditya and everybody present, we will upload this on the COVID Resource Center for you to refer. So the next question is from Navneet Mishra. My daughter is 7 years old and she's suffering from celiac disease.
Celiac disease, yeah. Yeah, she probably may be more at risk because in celiac disease, there is sort of a malabsorption syndrome. So sort of understanding that she may be a little more at risk may be helpful. That's all. You know, just shore up on her proteins, make sure that you're able to, you know, give her in shore up on the nutrition. And that's the maximum that you need to do. As and when a vaccine comes up, make sure that you're going to administer that to her. So otherwise, yes, to answer your question straight, she probably is comparing to other children. But I don't think you need to worry too much, just that, you know, from now on, have a very good, eye on what she eats and are we giving enough nutrition to her, enough proteins. Why I'm saying that is, we all have seen the real bad effects of COVID. Those images of, replaying on the news of so many cremations and all, they keep playing on our minds. But I think every one of us are exposed to at least two or three families where you never expected some old people with so many problems, they have survived and come out well. I personally know of at least three or four people. One was a 96-year-old. Another was a 91-year-old, another was an 88-year-old. All the three have come out. So there are so many who are done well. So it's not, you know, understanding that she may be at risk, but not getting scared about this, I think that's the way forward.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question is from Vikramaditya. The question is, does double dose will be needed, or every year vaccination will be required?
Yeah, that's a very good question. You know, a double dose is necessary because as of now, what is being given as of now, that is the one which has at least, showed up the immunity. However, now vaccination every year. You know, what's happening now is we are seeing that when you look at the antibodies, there are tests to even check the antibodies. Now, they've seen that the antibody levels go down after about 3 to 6 months or so. However, we are not still very sure whether these antibody levels are directly correlating with, again, COVID. Okay. So when the antibody levels are down, are all of them getting COVID? No, it's not so. They're also now relating it to what we call as a T-cell mediated immunity. So even if the antibody levels are not very high, if the T cell immunity is higher, which I'm not sure that there are so many tests now available to check it, but if that innately is higher, even with a low antibody level, patients do not get COVID. So now this is an emerging situation. However, as of today, if you see, the WHO is saying, let's vaccinate first doses more, whereas most of the advanced countries, which is UK, France, USA, all of them are going to go ahead with a booster dose for their medical personnel. Why I'm talking about medical personnel is because they were the first ones to get it. So they are talking about booster doses. That means that booster doses will be on for everybody, number one. Number two is that, you know, when the first vaccines and all came in, they were for certain variants only, what was available then. It was impossible for them to predict or make vaccines for the mutations which are happening. So now what most of the companies are doing is in their booster doses, they are trying to incorporate these things so that we get a good immunity for even the other gamma, delta variants. So I think, yes, there is going to be a booster. There probably will be a yearly vaccine from now until it comes up that the seropositivity is very high and until we start getting, you know, very little infections everywhere. Just like how smallpox and all went out. You remember those horrendous scars all of us have? You know, when smallpox was at its height, you know, everybody had those inoculation vaccines. And now that has been completely stopped because there are no infections.
Thank you so much. That's a lot of hope.
Yeah.
So the next question is again from Satya Prakash.
Yeah.
Is this still 3 months duration after which we should go for vaccination after recovery from COVID? Or we can go do it even prior to that?
See, the thing is, you know, a 3 month duration is actually going to help you. Because your native immunity after a COVID is actually naturally very strong. And it would be there for a minimum of 3 months. So boosting it with the vaccine dose is actually going to help you in the long run. That is why they are talking about. Although, you know, the government kept changing according to how much it had to provide vaccine doses, still the reason that, you know, it is going to boost the immunity actually sounds good. However, you know, certain people would like to go prior, particularly like the ones who are students or going abroad where you need to keep moving from place to place, taking care of old, infirm. In those places, you can go earlier. However, one thing what we need to remember even now is that, you know, the government has a tight control over vaccines, and that is how it's going to remain until at least about 60 to 70% of the population is going to be vaccinated. So even if we are going to want it prior, I don't think in India it's going to be possible unless you go for these, you know, vaccine tourism, which is happening. 28 days tourism and then Moscow, all that. If that is going to be a thing, that's a different thing. Otherwise, actually, you don't need it. 3 months and then go for your first dose. That is fine enough.
Thank you, ma'am. The next question is from Shweta Singh. And what she asks is that what can be the reason if a healthy person without any medical background passes away?
Yeah. So here, difficult to predict, but let me tell you certain observations from what I saw from the COVID infections, as well as what I saw within my family also. You know what, when COVID comes, the most important thing is, until then, what you have to do, you have to do. Like what I said, shore up on the nutrition, look up whether your vitamin D levels are right. If the vitamin D levels are not right, please start taking vitamin D. All that is different. Once COVID comes, please go for enough rest. That is the most important thing. Most of the people actually deteriorate because there is not enough rest. Just find out about, you know, people who like this have deteriorated very fast. You can very clearly see that they were actually running around. I'm not trying to point fingers, you know, it's a very family thing. If one person, for example, you know, a working person in the family, he gets COVID, kya hota hai? Man mein dar aa jata hai. Are yaar, family mein kisi aur ko aayega, un logon ko bhi test karna hai kya? And that is the time when infections are there everywhere. You're not able to do the lab test. Lab bande ko phone kar karke usi pe aap zyada time bita rahe hain, not taking rest. And so first, aapke test mein bhi itna time bita rahe hain, then next other person's test. Now with all this, what happens is the rest, what is necessary, is not being there. When the rest is not happening, it is like you're giving a green signal. Jo train mein hota hai na, sab jagah pe green signal hote jata hai. Bilkul waise, green signal for the virus to go, you know, absolutely haywire inside the body. So wo kya karta? Pehle, if you notice the COVID people jo jinko symptoms shuru aata, it would be classic if you really talk to them and see. Shuruaat mein cheek mein shuru hota. Fair, next day sore throat. You can just see the symptom getting down. And next will be, you know, they start coughing. After that, we all think difficulty in breathing. No, difficulty in breathing is later. The first symptom of a lung involvement is actually weakness to get up and go even to the toilet. So if these people start moving to a hospital by that time itself, recognizing that this is actually Meriko, you know, the infection is worsening. Nahi, nahi, main kaise taise try kar lunga. No. when there is a weakness to get up and go even to the toilet about 10 feet, 15 feet, that is showing lung involvement. So you, to answer your question, healthy person without any medical background, that person might not have taken enough rest, number one. Number two is very soon there is involvement of the heart muscle. So that is a very, very common thing which happens. You have to be very careful there. Rest is the most important thing. And with rest, even the ones where, you know, they might have deteriorated, 60% of them improve.
Ma'am, Shweta Singh is raising her hand, so yeah. I'll just allow her to talk. Shweta, yeah. Please go ahead and unmute yourself.
Yeah.
Hello, good evening, ma'am. And yeah, good evening, Madhu ma'am and sir. It's been a great privilege to have Lakshmi ma'am over here with us to answer our questions. Yeah, I would like to ask one more thing in regarding that, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Like when a doctor says that medically improvement hai, but not clinically, what does this mean?
When a person is there in an ICU or something, there is a day-to-day improvement from the parameters and from the symptoms. But does that translate into a person walking away from there? That is what we call that, you know, clinically. That means there has to be an uphill course. Now in COVID, kya hota hai? Now the fever itself, many of you would have seen, because apne ghar mein jab family mein aa jata hai na, if you look at other like typhoid and other infections, ab fever ke liye tablet dete hain, saath typhoid ka tablet bhi de dete hain, 4 din 5 din then fever starts coming down. Whereas in COVID, it was new for me also. I could not stop for at least 5 days after there was no fever. The minute you would stop, my son would get. We saw that. And then I got really worried when I rang up to my, because even though we were seeing patients, but we were not treating too many COVID patients. I am an oncologist. So I was looking at that side. And then it's my son, brother who told me, you better keep your alarm and start giving it every 6 hours. Okay. So like this, now you need to have an uphill course of recovery for the doctor to be comfortable to release a patient to be, you know, discharged. When that type of a thing they're not seeing, that is what they're saying. We are seeing a medical improvement. There may be an improvement in the parameters, in the lung parameters, but that is not showing a continuous improvement that the patient is able to get up and go. If they see an improvement, they also cannot ask the patient to get up and go, because the minute they exert themselves, immediately there'll be a fall. So they will take some time for them to recover and come out. That is what they say, medical and clinical.
Shweta, I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Sorry about that. I think I was a little fast on muting, huh? So the next question is from somebody whose name is not displaying. My COVID antibody IgG score is 289. Should I take vaccine now?
We are not talking about IgG scores alone for the vaccine. As of now, this is not correlated. Now, I am not very familiar with the 289 part, because from what we used to see, whatever I've done in my hospital is something below 8 is mild scores, and up to about 20 or so is moderate, and beyond that is good scores. Okay, so considering that, your COVID scores are good. I'm putting it as 28.9 in that sense. So in that sense, you are having good scores. I would still talk to you only about looking at how long it has been after your COVID thing. And if it's 3 months, please go for your vaccine. Don't delay your vaccine.
The next question is from Nicola Mammon. Doctor, a family member of mine who has recovered from COVID 2 months ago has developed parosmia.
Yeah, parosmia is altered taste or sense of smell. There is no medical cure. I can see that.
Okay.
But, from what we are seeing, they say that it takes about 6 months or so in certain people. But it sort of comes and goes. Okay. So probably, you know, because parosmia is something which is related to the nerves inside the nose also. So stimulating those nerves is probably going to help. So just like, you know, using certain strong scents, using alternatively scents with coffee and some, like, you know, lemongrass. So stimulating it probably can get it earlier, but she would get it. Don't worry about it. Yeah, whoever it is, it's a he or a she. It sometimes takes even up to about, 6 months. That's what I've heard.
Thank you. And I think this is the last question. We are also approaching the time scheduled.
Yeah.
So this is from Ashley Isaac.
Yeah.
He says, dear doctor, thank you so much for your time. Really appreciate it.
Yeah.
We all do, ma'am. And for children below 12 years, should we be concerned? My wife, I, and our oldest child is vaccinated.
Yeah, I understand that. But I think, no, we don't have to be concerned. It's just that once it is safe for the vaccine, for the children, let there be data, let the government safely sort of recommend it. You can go for the vaccine. Otherwise, I don't think we need to be so concerned, but just, you know, prepare yourself for it. That will be my only advice. There is no need to be concerned. In fact, I have seen personally in at least 3-4 families where 2 other family members were affected. The child was positive but did not have symptoms. As I showed you in one of the slides, 16 to 50% are asymptomatic. And this is what I've seen in many families with children, okay, where there was COVID. So not too much of concern, but yes, you know, how can you sort of shore up? Don't we all do it? You know, if we live in an area where there is more robbery, hum kya karte hain? Extra hum to ek, you know, grill door laga dete hain, you know? We all do something with that. So here, what can you do? It is about, you know, give good amount of playtime to your child, because exercise is going to again increase the amount of intake. You know, the child is going to feel more hungry. Then, you know, keep up on the nutrition. Otherwise, I don't think you need to be concerned. It's just that I'm expecting that we may come out with a good vaccine in within about 6 months or so. And not only, you know, vaccine like injectable, or so they are also developing nasal vaccines. So let us see which one comes out.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. You have been able to address all the questions in such simple words. It was very easy to understand. At this time, I would request Vishnu sir to speak a few words.
I'd like to, on behalf of all my colleagues here, I'd like to say thank you so very much, Dr. Jayalakshmi. As Ambalika very correctly highlighted, some of the most complex questions you were able to explain in such simple terms. We understand how difficult it is for a specialist to come down to common GP level, but despite being a oncologist, you've been able to address all our queries, and you've been able to explain how do we prepare ourselves. So really, thank you so very much for your time, and we do hope that this will be helpful for all of us, and we would be able to prevent it if it comes. Hopefully, it bypasses us, all of us, and that's what is our prayer. Thank you. Thank you so very much.
Mine too. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
On that note, I thank all of you for joining the session. We will have the PPT uploaded on the COVID Resource Center, and do reach out to myself in case you have any queries. We'll see if we can, request for the answers. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I'll send the PPT to you, Prema, then you can do it.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Jaya.
See you, Madhu. See you, Dr. Vishnu. See you, Vishnuji.